Hello, hello. Welcome to Say It Loud, Random Slabs of Music History, the show where each week my guests and I talk about a different random piece of music history. I am your host, John Terry. I will read our disclaimer. Welcome to Say It Loud. My name is John Terry. I'm the producer of this show. The things you will hear over the next length, the next hour and a half, represent the views of Say It Loud and the people making them. All opinions and quotations in no way represent River West Radio and are the sole responsibility of the producer, guests, and callers. River West Radio is not liable for any legal issues arising from the content of this program. So here we are. Say It Loud. I've got a special guest this week, Melissa Seifert. Melissa, say hello.
Hi, everyone. Thanks for having me, John.
All right. Well, thank you for being on. This is the second time that Melissa's been here to help me out. And today we're going to start. This is going to be one of what I'm sure will end up being several editions. I'm calling it The Bands That Begot Bands. And what really the organizing theme here is a band that, for whatever reason, and we're going to talk about this as we go through the show, that for whatever reason, every time somebody hears this band, they go home and start a band. And I think this is a fairly interesting concept. And so we're going to think about how this operates. We're going to think about how this operates and how this has been something that's important to music as a whole. There's going to be several bands that we could, you know, think about doing. Like I said, this is going to be round one, and we are picking the Velvet Underground. And now I think there's something about this phenomenon. It's not exactly when people go and listen to somebody like, I don't know, Jimi Hendrix or... there's probably several bands that would fit, right, that somebody goes and listens to them, and I know that this happens for me as a person in a really terrible band. You know, if I go and watch Hendrix, that's the kind of thing that makes me not want to be in a band, because I hear how good he is. And that's not to say that these bands are no good that we're going to be talking about, but there's something about these bands that when people see them, there's something about them that says, you know, maybe I could do this, or I really like this. These guys seem really cool, and maybe it seems like I could possibly do this. And I'm just going to say that the Velvet Underground, I think, is one of these bands. And now Melissa is coming in, and she is going to be our Velvet Underground expert for us. And so she's going to give us a lot of the background as we go. And eventually, oh, we've got some balloons blowing up in the background, folks. Eventually, I'm going to show us some of the bands that are directly inspired by the Velvet Underground. Of course, I'm not going to be able to hit them all because there's several, but I think that there's several interesting connections there. And so, since we're going to try and get in a lot of music, Melissa, why don't you take it away and tell us a little bit about the Velvet Underground?
Well, I think that you're right about the accessibility of their sound. Like, I can see why a lot of people would think, you know, like, let's start a band, we can do this. So for instance, Brian Eno, who, you know, came to be a well-known artist in his own respect, said, and this is a quote, "The first Velvet Underground album only sold 10,000 copies, but everyone who bought it formed a band." So if that says anything, well, and so first off, for those of you who don't know the Velvet Underground very well, I'm a big fan, so I'm really excited about being here. And they first became active in 1964, and then they kind of, like, the end of the Velvet Underground kind of, well, there's different permeations of the band, but the end would probably be 1973. So the original band is Lou Reed, John Cale, Sterling Morrison, and Angus McLeese. But, of course, this does change. So Lou Reed, obviously, on vocals and guitar, maybe the best-known member. Then John Cale on electric viola, and Sterling Morrison on guitar, and then McLeese on drums. And they originally had a band called the Warlocks, and then the Falling Spikes. And this is 64 to 65. And then actually in 65, they turned into the Velvet Underground because of a contemporary pulp fiction book that was written at the time, which was about the secret sexual subculture of the early 60s, and they really liked the idea of that, so they decided in 65 to call themselves the Velvet Underground. And then actually Maureen Tucker, who became the drummer, was also in addition at that time, which is most like kind of what we know now today as the Velvet Underground.
Okay, so that's the classic lineup.
Yeah.
Okay.
And then, I guess, in 66, Andy Warhol gets into the band and becomes a manager in 65 and 66.
So how does he get involved?
Well, as many of us probably know, he was very prominent in the arts, in the art scene in New mm-hmm. York, and the band is from New York. So he became really interested in their sound, really loud, kind of just sound music, mm-hmm. And suggested that they add Nico, who was a German-born singer at the time, because he liked her voice and thought it would go really well. And so he was very into them, and he had this factory in New York, his studio, mm-hmm. Which became kind of like a place for it's like a drug culture kind of place, and also a place for artists and creators to come together and make films. And so, like, Bob Dylan, mm-hmm. you know, was a frequent visitor. A lot of folks came in and out. Mick Jagger was another one. David Bowie. So
from the outset, this band was more than just music. It's about
it's about
culture.
Performance too, and it's very much about performance. But so Warhol's reputation helped them to get a contract with Verve Records, MGM, and they became part of Andy Warhol's multimedia traveling show called Exploding Plastic Inevitable. And actually, most of the first posters of the band called them the Exploding Plastic Inevitable rather than the Velvet Underground, because they were so integral to Warhol's traveling show. Mm-hmm. But either way, so their first album was featuring Nico, was called Velvet Underground and Nico. And here, let's play a song so people get an idea. This is called Femme Fatale.
All right, what's the year on this?
66.
All right, so here is Femme Fatale from the Velvet Underground, 1966. So that's 1967, did you say?
Yes, 1967.
Femme Fatale, and that's Nico. And for me, and this might go for a lot of people in our listening audience, when I think Velvet Underground, I don't necessarily think of Nico, but mm-hmm. there you have it, the first...
she actually only sang in 3 of songs on that album.
Okay, and she was only on that album, right?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, but, well, yeah. So, obviously, we don't know the true story, Mm-hmm. But lore has it that Lou Reed and Nico didn't get along very well. Mm-hmm. I think that they both wanted to be the star of the show, mm-hmm. and that didn't go very well. Which perhaps leads us into their next album, their second album, called White Light, White Heat. So the band sort of ended their relationship with Andy Warhol and subsequently ended their relationship with Nico, because mm-hmm. she was kind of like a, you know, add-on. Okay. So then their sound became much different, though, after that time. And much louder, much harsher, a lot more noisy. Even though the Velvet Underground and Nico disc is pretty noisy, like All Tomorrow's Parties, mm-hmm. which was Andy Warhol's favorite song, heroin, kind of about heroin, yeah. and pretty much like writing about parties at the factory.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But this one is much louder and harsher and a lot more extended improvisation. And some spoken word and some poetry and kind of stuff. And I don't know if we want to take, there's a song called The Gift that we're just going to play a little bit of because it's pretty long and it's basically a story that Lou Reed wrote. And then John Cale, who has this lovely English accent, is just basically reading the story over music. So this is just this very experimental a shift that happens with their second album, White Light, White Heat. And this is just a year later in 1968. Okay. So let's listen to just maybe a minute or something of The Gift.
Here comes The Gift. And interesting to note, we're two songs deep and no Lou Reed yet. We'll get to that. All right, we'll play a little bit of The Gift. And this also connects to a couple other songs that I've got in mind later. So this is a really good example. 1968, The Gift, The Velvet Underground from the album White Light, White Heat. Here it goes.
Waldo Jeffers had reached his limit. It was now mid-August. Jumenti had been separated from Marsha for more than 2 months. In 2 months, all he had to show were 3 dog-eared letters and 2 very expensive long-distance phone calls. True, when school had ended and she'd returned to Wisconsin, due to Locust, Pennsylvania, she had sworn to maintain a certain fidelity. She would date occasionally, but merely as amusement. She would remain faithful. But lately, Waldo had begun to worry. He'd had trouble sleeping at nights. And when he did, he had horrible dreams. He lay awake at night, tossing and turning underneath his pleated quilt protector, tears welling in his eyes as he pictured Marsha, her sworn vows overcome by liquor and the smooth soothings of some Neanderthal, finally submitting to the final caresses of sexual oblivion. It was more than the human mind could bear. Visions of Marsha's faithlessness haunted him. Daytime fantasies of sexual abandon permeated his thoughts.
All right, so we get a little bit of an example there, and I know you know people are familiar with that song. I know that song carries on, sort of tells the story, and he shows up dead in a box. And but interesting piece of music, and you know at the time, psychedelic rock and roll is something that was still in its infancy. So. Even though these songs maybe sound sort of quaint right now, that was definitely an interesting piece of music at the time. So, Melissa, tell us more.
Well, this album
Why haven't we heard from Lou Reed yet?
Good question. That's what I'm wondering, because I'm a big fan of Lou. So this album, it's pretty experimental, as you can see, with The Gift. And that's why I wanted to also play another song from the same album, so you can see the range. And there's a song called Here She Comes Now, which is a much more meditative kind of, Cale actually called this a conscious anti-beauty. So like realizing that we're just making noise, but it's this beautiful noise because it's somehow organized within the song, even though it's very chaotic. And this song was actually covered by Nirvana, Galaxy 500, and Cabernet Voltaire.
Okay, so a popular song.
And this is Here She Comes Now. Yeah, I mean, we can listen to it, and then note the differences between these two songs that are on the same album. you know.
And quite an album it is, too, which really sort of put them on the map without Nico. So here we go.
Right.
Give me the year. Oh, well, and we're still on.
Yep,
White Light, White Heat. So
we're still in 68.
1968. Here she comes now, the Velvet Underground, White Light, White Heat. Heat, quite a bit different, yeah, than the song that we had just heard before that, The Gift, which is basically spoken word poetry over some pretty heavy music. So take it away, Melissa. What's next for us?
Well, so Reed and Kale were kind of starting to go in different directions musically. And, you know, so this was our first actual song that's sung by Lou Reed that we just listened to, but even though he was, you know, he was basically writing a lot of the music and songs, even though he wasn't singing them always, but was very involved with that, and he had a little more of like a, you know, rock and roll slash pop, more not mainstream, but like a very more
of a pop sensibility.
A pop sensibility compared to Kale, who, you know, was from England and
playing electric viola.
And we should almost listen to Venus in Furs, which maybe we'll talk about later.
Yeah.
So if you compare these two styles, you can totally see where, I mean, Kale's going much more experimental, you know. And so they kind of, tensions began to sort of growing between the two of them on this album in 68. And so Kale decided to leave the band at this time, and Doug Yule joins. So this is still 68, and they have their third album, which was just called The Velvet Underground. And this is still in 68. And it didn't do as well. It had a little bit of a gentler sound, which you'll notice. And Doug Yule starts doing a little singing, too, and, you know, that's kind of Lou Reed's area, so we'll see how that tension kind of plays out as we go along. But you'll also be able to notice this kind of, there's kind of like a 50s ballad kind of sound that you might notice. So, well, here, yeah, why don't we listen to Candy Says, which is the first track on this album, and is a very, very nice, and you can notice this, the difference between White Light, White Heat, which is so like noise oriented and loud, and then there's this switch to the next album, so without Kale, and then it's much more mellow sound. So let's take a listen to Candy Says.
What year are we talking?
68 still.
Okay, still in 1968, Candy Says, The Velvet Underground, from the album self-titled The Velvet Underground.
Candy says, I've come to hate my body.
Definitely hear much more of a visible and pronounced pop sensibility after Kale has left the group, can't we?
Mm-hmm. Yes, yes. And it's actually kind of a funny story. Well, rumor has it that the band, well, I think this is actually true, that the band's, some of their like fuzz boxes and their big amplifiers and stuff were actually stolen while they were on tour before making this album. So that's, I mean, people have said that that contributed to their quieting sound, like their gentler sound. But I know Doug Yule doesn't, he doesn't agree with that. He says it's more like this is what they wanted to do and now they were able to do it. But And
so
I should
now,
mention
at least Doug is fitting Lou's vision.
And well, and I should mention that that song was sung by Doug Yule, not Lou, even though it sounds a lot like Lou.
Very much so.
But yeah, so then they went on the road in 69 and did like a new, they were kind of weren't getting quite as much cred in New York as they'd hoped to be getting. So did a European tour for a while, even though they kept like a home base in New York. Mm-hmm. And this was in 69 and they recorded a live album that actually got some credibility. It's called like The Velvet Underground Live 1969. Mm-hmm. With a lot of songs that would then show up on the Loaded album, which came then in 1970, after they signed with Atlantic Records for this last album, Loaded. And it's funny, the title, Loaded, of the album refers to Atlantic's request that it be, quote, loaded with hits, because they really wanted, they needed something that would sell big. And I mean, this is 1969, 1970, and so that's apparently why it's called Loaded. And it wasn't that popular, but it does contain some of the best known Lou Reed hits that a lot of people know, like Sweet Jane and Rock and Roll. Okay. But Reed and Yule didn't get along that well, as we said earlier. And then Lou Reed ends up leaving after this album to do his own solo performances, which we'll talk about probably more a little later. Mm-hmm. But I think on this album, it might be fitting to listen to Sweet Jane.
Give the people what they want.
Give the people what they want.
Okay. Here's a song that probably many of you out there know. Sweet Jane, The Velvet Underground, from the disc Loaded, and this is 1970. Here we go.
Standing on the corner, suitcase in my hand, Jackson's corset, Jane is in her vest, and me, I'm in a rock and roll band. Huh. Riding a Studs back at Jim, you know, those were different times. All the poets, they studied rules of verse, and those ladies, they rolled their eyes.
Sweet Jane, oh, 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 from the Loaded album, and now I hear you got another one in mind from
this
album.
Well, I do, because this is my favorite song, and well, and actually they had their last performance together this part of this
incarnation
of the group in 1970, and they didn't really perform together. And again, until 1974, and so we'll talk more about like what happened with Lou Reed and Doug Yule afterwards, because Doug Yule actually ends up taking on lead vocals and does his own thing, form of the Velvet Underground, goes on tour in the U.S. and in Europe from 1970 to 1972 without Lou Reed, but then Lou Reed goes on to do his own thing, which we will talk about. Mm-hmm. But just for my own pleasure, let's listen to "Oh Sweet Nothing," which is my favorite song, and I think a real crowd pleaser.
And Doug Yule, the vocalist on this track.
Yes,
here.
Yes.
So here we go. "Oh Sweet Nothing."
Thank you.
nothing. So now we've kind of ran through, and also, you know, as you noticed for the first time, Maureen Tucker was pregnant during that album, and so they had outside drumming help, and I think that you can definitely hear a difference in the drumming during that tune, something that I hadn't really paid attention to before. So now...
That was a nutshell of Velvet Underground history.
That was Velvet Underground in a nutshell. They're running from the first to the last album with the classic lineup. Although Doug Yule put out like a solo album under the moniker of Velvet Underground. It's basically a Doug Yule solo project. So there's the Velvet Underground. Let's talk about the influence. Like we said, starting out, this is part of my Bands That Begat Bands series here, number one. And I don't know when we'll return to this, but I'm sure that there's plenty out there that would fit this mold. But this is the kind of band that, especially I think when they're experimenting early on, people come and see the light show. They see the people in the crowd there. Of course, there's a lot of drugs around, all sorts of things that attract the kind of crowds. And so this is that kind of band that everybody goes and sees them. They want to go home and immediately start a band. And I just want to talk about some of their influences. And now here, I'm going to go to this riff, which really is kind of like one of the... becomes a classic. And a lot of stuff that we're listening to there was pretty soft in terms of the Velvet Underground. We're going to listen to things that are a little bit more, I don't know, hard-edged, a little bit noisier, a little bit harder to listen to, but to see how influential they are. And so I think there's a bunch of different varieties of music that become pretty clearly defined genres that take pages out of Velvet Underground's book. Like I said, so many bands were inspired by them. It's not like we can't really cover them all. And there are plenty of bands that don't even really sound like the Velvet Underground who are influenced by them. A lot of people would call them the first real punk rock outfit. And here's the song that usually gives them that tag. And it's 17 minutes long, and it makes up the whole second side of the White Light, White Heat album. So I'm just going to play like a couple of minutes of this. And you listen to this riff, and you'll already be thinking, this is the riff. This riff is the basis for hundreds and hundreds of songs. So here is Sister Ray from the Velvet Underground. We're going back in time to White Light, White Heat. One of these things that established, one is this is a completely repetitive two or three chord song here, completely repetitive, not really a bridge other than quiet, loud, or really the only dynamics, and they drone on for 17 minutes is one thing that you hear in this song. Another thing is probably the thing that well, most people, when they hear Loaded for their album, are probably thinking about Heroin, right, which becomes one of Lou's most famous songs, basically because of the content. But, you know, there's a song, Searching for My Main Line, the drugs are there, the raw noise, just sounds like a terrible recording, and I'm sure that they just maxed out everything and put it down on tape. But that riff becomes super influential, and that idea of that droning on, you can definitely hear how punk bands, and you know, really to think of the Sex Pistols as being 8, 9, 10 years out when these guys are doing this. Now, here's a band, and we could go through some of the punk connections, but I think that they're really obvious there. So I want to think about some different stuff. So maybe a post-punk type of band here, Joy Division, who was initially, by the time you get to New Order in the 80s, the band that developed out of the wake of the death of Ian Curtis, the singer for Joy Division, got a completely different, totally new wave of sound. But this is sort of before they become New Wave. This is their take on Sister Ray. So we'll just listen to a minute or two of their take on Sister Ray, and then a song that sounds exactly like Sister Ray, and I could pick hundreds that do, but here's Joy Division's take. And just listen to this, like, electronic drums or whatever, but you can see the influence is still there, and I love his vocal because it's so uncomfortable when he's trying to do this song. But here's Sister Ray from Joy Division. Taste of Joy Division's version of Sister Ray live. Shares the kind of recording quality sound, but I think that there's a better way to connect this band, Joy Division and the Velvet Underground. I got to give Ian Curtis a more fair shake at a vocal track there. But you hear this, a band that, you know, becomes New Order, that becomes really one of the biggest new wave, you know, kind of redefines in the 80s what pop sounds like. And a lot of other bands would fit this mold that were Talking Heads, Devo, all sorts of bands that become really big in the 80s that sound like they don't really have anything to do with this band from the 60s actually have a lot in common with them. And here I'll show you a song. This is the Modern Lovers, and this again is sort of a proto-punk, mid-70s, this is coming right on the heels of Velvet Underground's collapse, breakup. Jonathan Richman, a guy from Boston, the home of Doug Yule, actually, Doug Yule from Boston, was obsessed with Joy Division, sort of had a Lou Reed sound, and started to get a band together, and this is one of those strange bands in history. They record their first album in the mid-70s, and by the time it is finally released, they're already broken up and have totally sort of fallen off the face of the earth because of the long struggle to get this going. But John Cale produced some of their tracks. There are a bunch of complications, whatever, but here's the song Roadrunner, which is basically a Sister Ray ripoff, and there are many, many, many Sister Ray ripoffs. But we'll listen to this real quick, and then we'll talk about another sort of side of Velvet Underground, another side of the bands that they influence. So here we're going to hear from Jonathan Richman, the Modern Lovers, John Cale producing this, and I think the influence is pretty obvious.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Thank you.
the modern lovers of version of Sister Ray. And it seems like pretty much every post-punk, proto-punk, all these bands from the 70s long into the 80s, like all these bands have their particular version of Sister Ray. Like I said, just that idea, that riff, and then also the idea of the repeating, the repetitive nature, like this droning. And really, a lot of the people who I'm sort of looking for the influence here, we're kind of influenced by the John Cale side of Velvet Underground, early Lou Reed, more than Doug Yule and the later stuff. And here's a song, a fantastic song that we just have to play because we're playing, if we're playing the Velvet Underground, we just have to play this song. And this is from Velvet Underground and Nico, the first album. We're going to go back to Venus and Furs, and I'm going to reconnect this to Joy Division, and we got to listen to this whole song. And the noise in the background, sounds a lot like a sitar, which was becoming actually pretty popular around the time. This is after the Beatles had already kind of made it legendary, and you could hear this kind of sound on other tracks, but this is an amplified viola, so this is a guy playing a string.
And this is
instrument.
The type of thing that John Cale, you know, loved. Like, he, mm-hmm. this was this style that he was really into, and then if you compare that with Lou Reed, you can certainly see the where there were problems.
And you can hear just the mood that this song sets, mm-hmm. which I think brings it back around to some of the other stuff, and we'll talk about that. But let's just take a listen to Venus in Furs, the Velvet Underground, from the Velvet Underground and Nico, the first album, way back in 67.
Taste the whip, now believe.
in colors made of tears. Of leather, whiplash girl child in the dark. Severin, your servant, comes in bells, please don't forsake him. Strike, dear mistress, and cure his heart.
Now this is another, as they took their title from a novel. Now this, if the myth is true, is from a book that they found laying on the ground at the bus stop and wrote a song about it. Now this is interesting. We've listened to this, been listening to the Velvet Underground all day here, and really there's not a lot of songs in their collection that sound really very much like that, but every time I hear that song, I think that is the quintessential Velvet Underground song, and I think it's the mood that it sets. So I'm going to really quickly put on another song that I think that really fits that mood, and this is Joy Division again, giving them another chance, and I think that it's pretty obvious that they were inspired by that kind of sound as well. So here is Day of the Lords from Joy Division, Unknown Pleasures, and this came out in 79, so this is still pretty early. Not quite punk, not quite new wave, but definitely in the vein of Venus and Furs. Thank you. So that is Day of the Lords from Joy Division, a band that is obviously taking a page out of the Velvet Underground book there. And now here's even a more obvious example. And again, now this is another band, and this is something that speaks to John Cale, Doug Yule, maybe if not as much Lou Reed. They're notorious collaborators and producers and people who stay connected to the business. So John Cale, in particular, has produced several albums. And these guys are all part of a circle who collaborates with the likes of David Bowie, Brian Eno, we mentioned earlier. You know, and these are the guys who are also producing several other albums. So Brian Eno won Grammys producing U2 albums. He produced like 6 U2 albums, including the Joshua Tree. All sorts of connections here through John Cale to all sorts of other music. Mick Ronson as well, the David Bowie glam rock scene, which Lou himself sort of gets involved in. And we'll listen to that in just a second. I want to play one song here just to show you. So there we've got this, maybe the first post-punk band before punk is even over there from 79, Joy Division. Ian Curtis is dead by the time their big hit Love Will Tear Us Apart comes out in 1980, which really starts a sort of new wave trend. And here's a band, the Dream Syndicate, part of a sound labeled the Paisley Underground, which I think is not a good title. But also, this is another album produced by John Cale. They named themselves after the Dream. The Dream Syndicate is the name of the band. They named themselves after a New York experimental band from the early 60s that John Cale was in, the Theater of Eternal Music, and they had this passage, the Dream Syndicate. So that's where they get their name, and they are with John Cale, aware of him as well, and this is very much playing off of that. And I think that I'm going to play sort of an interesting track. Maybe people are familiar with the song Tell Me When It's Over, which is the Dream Syndicate's big hit, a really underrated band. They only put out 2 albums. But here's one going back to one of the first songs, Femme Fatale, and on a couple of their tracks, they have their bass player, a woman, sing, and this is very much playing on a Nico-sounding Velvet Underground song. So I'm going to play Too Little, Too Late from the Dream Syndicate. This is from the very early 80s here. The Days of Wine and Roses, a great album. Here's Too Little, Too Late. Thank you. beautiful song from the Dream Syndicate, The Days of Wine and Roses, an album I recommend everybody goes out and gets because it's fantastic and it's underrated. So there are some bands that are very obviously taking off from the Velvet Underground, ranging from proto-punk to post-punk to pretty much straight-up new wave there, just to show you how varied the influences are. And before we go back to Lou, the man himself, and talk a little bit about his connections, let's just play some covers, a couple of covers that also connect him to a different sort of sound, and this is maybe something that would be a little bit more unexpected. Jane's Addiction and Nirvana, two bands out of many, many bands that have covered Velvet Underground songs, but I think it's interesting, and it seems like I've somehow have had Nirvana in every show that I've done so far, but how these bands, how this would connect to grunge. So here you've got late 80s, Jane's Addiction, has to be 88, looking back 20 years at that point to a band from the 60s and playing rock and roll live on their first album. So here's Jane's Addiction doing their version of rock and roll, and you can hear Dave Navarro spice it up a little bit, but it's essentially the same take, and you can hear how much... if you listen to their catalog, you can maybe start to hear these influences a little bit more. So here's Jane's Addiction, rock and roll. Quite a spin on there, and a rare lightning production move here. Also, another quick example of Jane's Addiction. Now, hopefully, I'm just going to pray that this is the right song here, but listen to this and see if we hear that Venus in Furs here. The electric violin, which is a rare instrument in grunge, I would say, and listen to this throwback to just this opening part, this throwback to a Venus in Furs kind of sound. Mm-hmm. hear that bass line in the background there, I just wanted to show that just how closely connected a band that probably you wouldn't really think of as a Velvet Underground disciple, very much taking from that. And one last band, Nirvana, I want to play them covering Here She Comes Now, and I think that they're going to bring us sort of full circle to a couple of other bands as we're nearing the end here. We'll come back with some comments and some questions, but here is Nirvana's version of Here She Comes Now, and remember we listened to the song earlier. It's a 5-minute version. I don't know if we're going to listen to it all, but they definitely extend it, and this is just sort of them playing around. This comes off the box set, so this makes me think that when they're messing around a lot in the studio, a band like Nirvana, probably experimenting with this kind of song, jamming out sort of for the fun of it, because of their ability to do this sort of droning kind of jam session type tune. So here is Nirvana doing a sort of unorganized version of Here She Comes Now. Got the box set, you can hear them. They kind of just play around with that song for a few more minutes. And I think, you know, the thing that I'm trying to show here is you got a band like Joy Division, and that is obviously taking from the sort of Venus and Furs type sound, the noise, the John Cale oriented material, the noisier stuff. And you can hear Jane's Addiction is doing both, right? They've kind of got that sound going. They also are covering rock and roll, which is sort of probably one of the poppiest, peppiest, one of the biggest hits from the Velvet Underground. And then there you got Nirvana going to something really, really soft there with a band that is always, you know, notoriously linked with much harder material. So you can kind of just see that it's, even if, you know, you can see these different types of Velvet Undergrounds within the Velvet Underground, all these other bands are seeing that and playing that on that as well. And then, now Melissa, I think that you had a question.
Well, I was curious, do all of these bands identify with their with Velvet Underground as being a big influence, or do they kind of say, no, you know, we sound like them, but we are not, you know, influenced?
I think with a band, Velvet Underground has something a bit of a, and like you had said this earlier, right, it's not necessarily about how many records they sold. And, you know, I would imagine right now that Nirvana is, I'm sure, well outsold them, even though they've had 30 more years or 20 more years to be selling records. It's not necessarily how many they sell, but how influential they are.
Mm-hmm.
And the Velvet Underground gets this sort of cult fame and recognizes these punk innovators. So I think on some level, you know, attaching yourself to Velvet Underground has always been cool. We see it from very shortly after, you know, the Modern Lovers are totally copping the sound a year after the band breaks up. The end of the 70s, you see Joy Division doing it. In through the middle of the 80s, you see a bunch of other new wave bands that are sort of hitting on that. The Paisley Underground sound is influenced a lot by that. And then all the way to 90s grunge. And I guess really, you know, it would be up to somebody else to see where that's going
now, or who has sort of taken up the reins. Another band, REM, is another band that is always saying that they love Velvet Underground. So you've got a few of these bands that really attach themselves to it. And then I think that you have some bands that might not be aware, but I don't think that you'd have any band that would try to distance themselves from the Velvet Underground, mm-hmm. even though okay. Lou Reed himself sort of had a different reputation. So now, and in that, since we're playing Nirvana there, I think there's an interesting way to tie all these together. Let's listen to a Lou Reed solo track here. We're going to listen to Vicious. And this album was produced by Mick Ronson and David mm-hmm. Bowie. David Bowie, of course, the man who sold the world, which is a song that Mick Ronson was working with him on, also was covered by Nirvana fairly famously on their Unplugged album. So to tie them all together, we're going to bring in Lou Reed's solo stuff here.
So this is his second solo album, just to be clear, mm-hmm. from 1972.
Okay, so this is well...
Transformer.
And this is while Yule is playing under the Velvet Underground moniker mm-hmm. here. And so I guess this is one of those things that shows you maybe what Lou's direction was. And I think this is a great song to do that. So here's Vicious from Transformer. Transformer, and I think that song, something about those vocals where he has a very theatrical kind of vocal style that I think carries through a lot of his solo material that you don't sometimes get as much off of Velvet Underground stuff now. So before we wind up, Melissa, do you got any last comments, last words?
Thanks for having me. It's been lots of fun.
All right. Well, thank you very much for coming on. Thanks for anybody out there listening or anybody listening through the archives. And remember, as always, please come on down here right to the middle of Center Street and get yourself down to River West Film and Video, the ultimate place to rent and purchase your videos. Thank you again for listening. Next week, I think that I'm going to do a show about connections to Wisconsin. So I'm going to play us out here with a David Bowie song. As I said, this kind of ties us up. So David Bowie produced Transformer shortly after releasing this song. So here is The Man Who Sold the World from David Bowie. Thank you again for tuning in. And as always, come on down to River West Film and Video, the place to get your films and videos. Thank you.
We passed up on the stairs. We spoke of what and when. Although I wasn't there, he said I was his friend, which came as some surprise. Spoke into his eyes, I thought you died alone a long, long time ago.